Then the third challenge here, I don't even give you the usernames or the password possibilities. You have to try, and you will get overly informative error messages that give you a little bit of guidance, but it gets closer and closer to what you have to do to break into real websites. And then, after I've been teaching that course for a while, Heartbleed hit. And this was a real pivotal moment in computer security, because before this, there was a common thing people would say, which is Linux is more secure than Windows. And people even had sophisticated, intelligent-sounding arguments as to why Linux was more secure than Windows. And this proved that that was all false. You had this gigantic gaping hole that leaked out the secrets out of every website based on Linux for 2 years, and nobody even noticed. And so everyone jumped on this. I think nobody in my field got sleep for 3 days when this hit, because it was not only important, it was easy to do the attack. So some version of it you could write. And I was immediately making projects and demonstrations. The one I made was I made a malicious server where if you connect to it with an Android phone, it will steal the RAM out of your phone. Because it works both that way and the other way. And so here's the number of bytes I was able to steal from these phones. I could steal 16,000 bytes of RAM off the phone. That was fun, and one, there was a big contest, see, because when this first happened, it was perhaps an unimportant flaw. It meant that you could trick it into handing you 64 kilobytes of random memory out of some region of memory, and the initial analysis was that probably there was nothing very important in that region of memory, except a temporary cache of pages it had shown previous viewers, so under most circumstances there'd be nothing interesting in there. And the big question was, are you ever going to get the private HTTPS key in that part of memory? And nobody knew, but they thought not. So Cloudflare, a local company in San Francisco that does a lot of good things, they set up an enterprise class strong server and said everybody can attack this server and see if you can get the private key. And within about 8 hours, someone did get the private key. And it turned out that under normal conditions, the private key is not in the vulnerable part of RAM, but if you've just rebooted the server, it does go there briefly. So you'd have to hit the server with a DOS attack or something. And what happened is at some point the server crashed and restarted, and then the guy got the private key. So my students were trying too, and one of them found what he thought was the private key right away. Now it turned out this was a fake private key. After the first guy found it, it was then floating around in RAM, and then people put up fake ones. But he found something that looked like the private key, so I put it on Twitter. And he got a job immediately. Immediately one of the local employers that hires our interns said, I want to hire this guy right now. And this got my attention. I said, you know, this is, we try to give people degrees and certificates and we think they're going to get a job, but what really gets you a job is to be visible in the competition of security. And what he liked here, of course, is not necessarily this was the perfect attack, but that this guy is paying attention. The new thing comes out within 3 days, he's doing the new attack. That's what you need. Somebody that loves security that's right with it, if you're going to be at the forefront of the industry. And so, I then moved to try to make classes that would prepare you for things, and one of the problems I noticed is that I could never do the DEF CON capture the flag or the DEF CON capture the flag qualifier, which is the most prestigious CTF in the world. It is impossibly difficult, and I still can't, but I got a little closer by teaching exploit development. This is the famous book, Shellcoder's Handbook, that started this thing. It's again an old book, but it's the Bible for the field. If you have an attack that makes a server crash, it is possible to improve that attack so you take over the machine. In many cases. It's not always possible, but it can be. And it all started with Aleph Null in Frack Magazine writing how to smash the stack for fun and profit. And then variations on that attack are most of the attacks we're using now. So the simple one here, you start a server listening, and you type down here, you type in a message, and it will just echo up here. You put in hello, it'll echo hello up there. The point is you have to have a string manipulation routine so that you have a chance to overflow the buffer. And the point here is you have a buffer that's 1024 for the string, but you copy something into it that is not limited in length. It's the basic fundamental error. So a simple attack just prints 1100 A's. And if you feed that in, that will cause the server to crash with a segmentation fault, which is a defense mechanism to prevent you taking over the machine that detects it. But anyway, now you've... That means it crashed, and the most likely reason it crashed is that you ended up putting those A's in the instruction pointer. So to find that, you make a non-repeating pattern. I put in 1,000 A's and then 000102, some kind of pattern, and then you send that up to the server. And if you do that, it will crash, and it will tell you it crashed with 1819 in the instruction pointer. It goes in there backwards. So now I know which bytes end up in the instruction pointer. If I can control the instruction pointer, I can redirect code execution to run code I injected. And so you have to get code to inject. Now that book, Shellcoder's Handbook, will teach you how to write your own shellcode in assembler. Typically what you want out of shellcode is it will phone home to your command and control server and then give it the ability to issue commands. But you can just get it from Metasploit. MSF Venom will make shells. This is the simplest one. that opens a listening port on which you can connect to. This is a pretty weak attack because anybody that isn't completely stupid has got a firewall in front of their server, which blocks all the ports they aren't using. So even if this exploit works, you won't be able to connect from the outside, but it is a way to get started. And the cool thing about the exploit is you can, it just writes it in any language you want. For example, it just writes it there in Python. So now you just add that to your code and send it up, and then you have to run it through a debugger. I use GDB as the standard. It is extremely user hostile, but you can get used to it. So you put a breakpoint in the code right after it has accepted the long string, but before it has tried to return and crashed. And so you look at the stack frame. Every time you enter a subroutine, there's another another block of memory is allocated on the stack. That's the stack frame for that one subroutine. And when you return from the subroutine, it'll go to the return pointer down here. So this stack frame starts here and it goes to here, ending in a highlighted area. And so, right after the stack frame for this subroutine is the return value. And this is me hitting it with A, B, C, D. And that's what you want. So what I've got, this is a proper exploit. First you have just a bunch of padding, 1,000 A's. Then you have a bunch of no operations, 90s, that will just do nothing, but they are executable instructions. Then you have the egg, which is the payload for Metasploit that will actually do the malicious thing I want to do, in this case, opening a listening port. And then I have this, which is under my control, A, B, C, D. Now all you have to do is we have to stop it here because you have to find out where you are in memory. And I can see that my NOP sled is here. So I have to pick any address in the NOP sled and put it there. And then when it overflows and tries to return from this, it'll return to this, slide down the sled, and do the egg. And that's how you take over machines. There's the classic alpha null way to do it. And if you do that, you create a listening shell. So the server's running up here, you inject this long string, which is in this text file, and then you end up with a listening port on 4444. The server's still running, but it's not running the code that the developer wrote anymore, it's running the code I injected. And that's what you want. So you now have our remote code execution, and you can take over servers. Now that you're listening on that port, you can connect from anywhere and have a root shell. And so I have various challenges where they do it on a local machine and a remote machine, and then they start taking over real servers. I have a couple servers that I put attack in front of them. I rent them from DigitalOcean, and people just take over that server various ways and deface it. And that makes fun projects. They end up on these winners pages. I'm modeling after capture the flag competitions, and this is fun for people. So one of the big ones was SQL injection. This one started something that's been a big deal in my life for a while. I'm not sure. I'm not sure recommending an abusive relationship, but that's where I learned to take a lot of abuse. And this is a valuable skill, to be able to let people pick on you and yell at you and abuse you and swear at you and you don't even care, which I came about. So criminals teach me a lot. So in this case, I made a SQL injection vulnerable page, which I was glad for the cloud because I never would have dared to do this before because anybody can take over your server. And the main attack I knew about was if you have your have select query, that select username from users where username like the name, and the thing you get to put in is the name, you can make a string like this that has apostrophes in it that causes it to do a second select query and print out the answers in the name. So this will dump out the names and social security numbers from the database, which I'm not supposed to be able to see. And that's the classic SQL injection attack, which is the most important weakness in all computer security and responsible for more than 90% of all stolen data. But you can do more with this. And the way I learned is I put up this page demonstrating SQL attacks, and then people kept hacking my page in ways that I hadn't planned. I thought they would steal the social security numbers. These guys would go to my winner's page, put up pop-up boxes, images on the page, and stuff that I didn't think he could do. And then I would say, how did you do that? And he said, well, figure it out. You're supposed to be so smart. You always get entries like this. And I said, well, I looked at my logs. There's nothing in the logs. I said, well, this is pretty rude. And so I learned about PHP shells, which are bloody awesome. This command will put up a PHP shell. It will put this stuff into a file. And that is a PHP file that will execute a command in a shell. So all you have to do then is go to this shell with cmd equals who am I date, and you'll get who am I date. You can put anything you want there. And the interesting thing about that is that not only do you have the ability to inject arbitrary commands, it doesn't show up in any logs. You're not logged in as a bash user. It's not in the bash history. So I still could not figure out how he was doing this, even after I upgraded my page a couple times. And this got me into the world of honeypots. You put up honeypots, which is essentially what these servers are, expecting them to be hacked, and hopefully having some kind of logging and defense on them so you can learn what the attackers are doing. And so I tried various techniques. One of the ones that failed was full packet captures, which I then put in Dropbox to exfiltrate from the machine. But the problem is, when it put the packet capture in Dropbox, Dropbox would then send it up to the server, which would create more packets and made a runaway explosion with self-positive feedback. And even when I excluded it, all the traffic was HTTPS. Most of the interesting stuff was. So I wasn't able to read it anyway without a key. And it was just pretty much useless, which is something I learned from forensic class I'm teaching this semester. I'm going through Kevin Mandia's incident response book. And he says, the first thing you do to collect evidence from a system is usually too stupid, like image the whole hard drive, image the whole RAM. All you do is make a giant pile of data that's going to take you a week to dig through. This is not how you really get to the end. You have to carefully target useful data. I don't want the whole hard drive. I want like a few log files that tell me what I need to know so I can get moving on this thing. Otherwise, I'm still messing around with it a month later while the hacker is rampaging through a system. And one of the products that really works is Tripwire. Tripwire is free, the Linux version, and all this does is something I used to do by hand. I didn't even know there was a product. You calculate the MD5 hash of every file in the box. Make a table of that. This only takes a few seconds to do. Then you notice if it changes. That's all it does, but it's very nice. It gives you a complete report as often as you feel like running it. I run it in a cron job every 10 minutes. A lot of other people run it just once a day. And then I just have another cron job that harvests just the bottom line, which is how many violations are there, how many files have changed from the log. And I know six of them are just me doing a few things, and then I did a few more things, and it's 12. And I can just look down this, and if somebody hacks me, that number will change. And if it does go up to 19 or 20, I've been hacked, and then I can look at Tripwire, and it will tell me exactly which file was changed. So that's really nice. You know, that was the most efficient way to find out what I need to know without flooding me under a pile of useless data. So the next one actually created quite a lot of trouble. This was another attack that came out in April of this year. And this was a pretty big thing in Linux security. Again, although not as big as Heartbleed, but still pretty big. There's an image magic library used by almost every website that processes images on Linux. And it had a serious code injection vulnerability. And what it was you could just upload. Yeah, let's see, let me bring it up live because I didn't put the exploit there. And I'll show it to you. This is attack 32 im.htm. All right, so there's the vulnerability. What you do is you make a file with an image extension, like JPG or GIF or something, and you just put text in it, because ImageMagick has the ability to handle images with metadata. You can specify something like the background. You can fill it with a color, and you can even load the color from a remote website. And if you do load it from an HTTPS website, the way it's actually coded by the developer is to switch languages. And switching languages is how you create code injection vulnerabilities. It's a fundamentally stupid thing to do, but it's usually the fastest way to make your program work if you don't care about security. Like you have PHP, and so you build a command line of SQL. That's how you end up in trouble, because you're building a command line which will then be parsed at the other end by trying to match the quotes. And if the attacker can put in quotes, they can mess up that parsing and put in active content where they should only be putting in passive content. And so what this thing does is in the ImageMagick library, it builds a line of bash shellcode and it uses curl to fetch this data. So it's curl plus whatever's here. So if you put in these particular combination of quotes, you can now put in arbitrary commands like echo. You can do a command injection in what should have been an image. And this was a real vulnerability. People were very upset. All the Linux distributions were scrambling to put up patches in April. And so within a week of it going up, just like Heartbleed, I had some demonstrations going. I went to conventions and people were hacking into my page with ImageMagick attacks, which is fun. And it amounts to the same thing. You just put bash shell commands right there. It's actually dash shell commands, but it doesn't matter. It's pretty much the same. And anyway, so I put this up, but it was fine. And I went around and did it at DEF CON and HOPE and all over the place. And then, about 3 weeks ago, suddenly this page was gone. When the students tried to do their homework, the page is gone. I said, oh, somebody probably hacked my server again. Let me take a look. And I look, and the page is still there. And I said, but you just can't see it when you go to it. So the other pages are still going up. I looked at the permissions, and they're fine. So I said, well, let's track this down. I made a copy of the page, and it's invisible. Then I just start deleting large parts of the page to see when it becomes visible again. It turns out that this text is causing my page to be invisible. So I immediately guessed what's going on. My cloud provider apparently is using some sort of security solution, like an active firewall, that it identifies this as an attempt to attack somebody. because it's moving those exploit around, which is kind of hilarious. And what you usually get with these antivirus-like solutions, you have an exploit comes out, there's a big excitement about it, everybody gets attacked, everybody patches their stuff, and 6 months later they wander in and add it to their definitions when it's no longer useful, and it breaks everything. So they interpret my page as an evil page hosting malware now. So all I had to do was encode this, ampersand APOS semicolon, ampersand quote semicolon, and suddenly it's up again. So that was pretty silly. But the next thing that happened is the college complained, say we have an attack, we have a some evil server on DigitalOcean is attacking our college. First our college sent a bunch of attack packets to it from your lab, and then it sent a bunch of attack packets back to our lab. So what are you guys doing now, and you better knock it off? And I'm like, dude, I know exactly what happened, and you guys don't. But I said, you know, rather than try to fight with you guys who seem kind of resistant to understanding things, I'll just switch my page to HTTPS. And magically those attacks will all vanish. Which is what the bad guys do too, which is why anybody that cares about security does not let you use encrypted tunnels into and out of your organization. If you do that, all those defenses don't work. Not that they work that well anyway. But anyway, so this gets me over to vulnerability disclosure, which is something that all beginning security people have to come across. At first, you work hard, you learn security, you learn how to find vulnerabilities, you find a vulnerability, and you tell someone, guess what, I found a vulnerability. Boy, are you going to like pay me money or say thank you, and that never happens. You're lucky if they don't punch you in the face and lock you in prison. Nobody ever wants to hear about their vulnerability. The natural response of all authority figures when told something is to just shoot the messenger and carry on. Doesn't matter who they are, security companies do the same thing. RSA, one of the biggest security conferences in the world, well, they found a vulnerability on their website. One of the companies that had paid like thousands of dollars for a booth called up and said, dude, your login form has like a vulnerability, so they banned them from the conference. How dare you embarrass us in this way? And then, of course, we're more embarrassed than ever when those guys went public with that. But anyway, so it's a tough thing to tell people about vulnerabilities. They don't want to hear it. But one thing, it's also illegal to find a vulnerability on a website. You're breaking the law just by finding it. Even if all you do is a Google search and find something that the author of the website did not want you to see, you have now broken the law. That's how the CFAA is written. This is in general true of computer law because there is nobody, and nobody can figure out how to define what a computer crime is. If you like to say running code on your box that breaks it without even asking you first, if that's a crime, then Windows Update is a crime. Because Windows Update does that all the time. And yet you don't want to stop that. So there's no actual clear definition of exactly what is it that makes it a crime when I hack into your website and dump out all the cigarette card numbers on the web, or when Microsoft puts on an update and crashes your box. Why is one of these a crime and the other is not a crime? What exactly is the difference? And so they punch. They say doing something you're not authorized to do is a crime. So that means the people that make the website just get to decide whether you were authorized to do that or not. And anyway, so this means the only way to let people tell you about your security problems is to exempt yourself from the law voluntarily. And I've been after the CodeCamp people to do this. When I first came here, I think 2 or 3 years ago, my talk was about all the holes in the CodeCamp website. It was making all kinds of security mistakes. And he proved it somewhat, but he still doesn't have a vulnerability disclosure policy, and I highly recommend one. This is mine. I got it from BugCrowd. They wrote a nice, simple one in English that is not baffling legal terms that no one can understand, and all it says is what I really want to say, which is if you find a security problem and do it in some way that doesn't really hurt anybody and give me some time to fix it, then I will not prosecute anybody who tells me about a website. Of course, I have a few rules. Like, you can only hack my site. You can't go hacking the college because I'm not authorized to allow that. I would like to talk college into doing this, but I haven't succeeded yet. And if you actually like take down the site for a month and nobody can do their homework, then that would exceed my parameters in which I promised not to prosecute. And on you go. But if you do it, then you end up on the Hall of Fame. And immediately people started hacking me. It was cool. My Hall of Fame has a lot of fun people on it. One of the first guys was Anonymous, an OnSec in some other country. I think he's Israel or Palestine. He's a Palestinian hacker because he put freedom for Gaza, long live Palestine. So what he did was I had these PHP scripts to put links on my page for students to refer to the relevant links to the lectures. And a long time ago, there was no password at all on that. The only security was that the name was not obvious, so you'd have to find the name. And then after a while, people started putting like Advil Viagra and stuff in there. So I put a password on it, it was only one letter wrong. And that worked for about 4 years, and then I made the password longer. But he found a really old page from a class I hadn't taught in years that had no password at all. You could just put up links. So he put this up, and I left it up. I put him on the Hall of Fame. Okay, he found a phone, he exploited it, it's for real. And someone said, you're letting this terrorist put slogans on your page. And I said, well, you know, that's not a bad slogan, freedom for something. If he said kill somebody, I would have took it down, but this is a fair cop. He he found a hole, he put up a message. It's not the end of the world. Sure, freedom for Palestine, I guess. I don't know much about it, but I've even lived. So then one of my students started hacking. This guy was pretty good. He would watch carefully in lecture and notice when security features appeared briefly on the screen as I was demonstrating stuff on my page and hack in. So he was sneaking a cross-site scripting attack past my filters by filtering it in exotic ways. And this guy is really great. A student came who was actually in vulnerability research at Google. And he came to take our classes. He was way, he didn't know, he took the exploit development class. That got his attention. He's, well, I didn't know they had a class like this around here. This is great. And he knew a lot. So he rooted my main server, which is not intended to be a target. My live servers are intended to have vulnerabilities and get hacked. But my main server is not even a server control. It's a hosting, a web hosting at 1&1. And they update everything and looks pretty good, but he totally got through over the whole page and rooted it and put up a banner on the main page. And it's, man, that's worth a lot of points. That's really great. He hacked into what I thought was my secure server. And then the next, he found out my kernel was out of date. So I tried to update my kernel, and the next week, another student hacked it the same way. And then I learned that the hosting provider I had for this box, I think this is still one of my attack servers, that's right. But the hosting provider I had here, I think it was, this one was in DigitalOcean, and if you update your Linux kernel, it doesn't have any effect because they bypass the grub bootloader, and it's somewhere in their system on their control page that controls the kernel version. So you update and it still boots the old kernel. I didn't know that, that's how I found out. I was still getting hacked. You have to go into their configuration page, nothing in your server to control the kernel version. And this one was pretty good. This guy was the most dangerous hacker I had. This guy got in my email 4 times, he got in my Twitter account 3 times, he got my login password, and I gotta show you, he did the technical stuff too, but the most dangerous attack has always been social engineering. And here's one of the things he did. They were sticking about this for a week. I was in the lab, and he snuck up behind me with his cell phone and videotaped me logging in. So I'm just in the lab, you know, doing stuff, answering student questions. Then suddenly he grabs the guy, gotta show you this, takes him out in the hallway, they're stickering about something. What's that? Oh, never mind. They put this up like a week later than they showed it to me. But I said, this is a really scary attack. I don't know much of any defense against this attack. Another thing he did, twice, I was teaching a class like this right here, and somehow, during lecture, he walks up there and types in a tweet. Nobody says a word. I'm standing here. He's so smooth. I still don't know how he did it, but he was just good at this. You know, that's social engineering. You know, if you act like you belong there, everybody will just not look at you twice. I had another one where a student was in a huge room, like 300 people are having a Microsoft launch of Windows 7 or something. 4 classes all came together to go to this official event. They had a big table like that in the front, and one student in the front row, his laptop was out of power. So he put his laptop right here on the table and plugged it in and watched the talk. At the end of the talk, hundreds of people leave the room, he walks over there and it's gone. Right in front of 300 people, somebody grabbed his laptop, walked out the door, nobody saw a thing. Because, you know, if you don't act guilty, nobody will even know. So some guy picking up his laptop. Anyway, so that was, and of course now they get extra credit, they get on the Wall of Fame, they get rewarded for this, which is what I think should happen. And that's good. So this gets us into Capture the Flags. Capture the Flag competitions are difficult to get into at first because they're all too difficult. Especially if you start with the famous ones like the DEF CON. The DEF CON Capture the Flag is insanely difficult, and the qualifier is now insanely difficult. I don't even try it anymore. You might as well just get in the ring with Muhammad Ali, get squashed to a flat, and what good was that? But there are easier ones. PicoCTF is a training tool that came from, I think, Carnegie Mellon. It was intended to be easy, and now it's not even a live competition. It's just a set of, you know, game you can play anytime. There are like 50 challenges. They start out extremely easy, like a web page where the password is in source code, or some password that's just base64 encoded or something like that. And then they get a little harder and a little harder until you're doing really advanced stuff. And it's fun, and there are write-ups for everything. If you just Google PicoCTF Challenge 4, everybody's written in their blog how to solve it. So if you get stuck, you can get help. And it's not a real competition where you win anything, but this is where I start students. I say, do this first because anybody can do the easy ones, and it helps you develop. This is a good training tool. Whereas most CTFs are not really such good training tools, you have to be pretty advanced to even have a chance. And it's even got a graphical game board, which I ignored, but it does have this where you're wandering around picking up things and there's a sort of story, or you can just view it where just the pictures are, and on you go. And here's one, you got an encrypted message, and it's encrypted with the Caesar cipher. So, you know, you just have to move the letters forward in the alphabet to decrypt it. And there's websites that'll do that. You can write little Python scripts to do it. There's plenty of ways to do it. But it starts here. Then there's an easy series of CTFs. This one is one of our favorites. the high school hacking competition, one of the great things about high school CTFs, the first thing is the problems are not as difficult. The second thing is it lasts for a whole week. Most CTFs are modeled after the DEF CON one, which is a face-to-face one where you go in 2 or 3 days without sleep hacking away, which is what really happens in the real world at a security team when it's an emergency, but it's not really what happens at schools. And it makes a lot more sense to give us a whole week so people can fit it in around their classes and homework and everything without having to just give up. And this one, we've done quite well on this one, and there's a series of other similar easy ones, and these are not too easy. The hard ones here are really hard. You don't get them all. I don't know what high schools these guys are at, but they're way ahead of my college. And that, of course, is something I discovered right away when I went to DEF CON, is all my classes, my most advanced classes, do not make you the best hacker in the world or anything close to it. There's nowhere, and then there's like people who have gone to ordinary college courses, and then there's enough to get a job up here. And my classes might get you enough to get a job. And then there's winning the DEF CON CTF is way up here. That's like people that have worked for 10 years at an antivirus company or something. And they're way above entry-level skills. All I can do is get people entry-level skills. Then when you get in a company, you won't be totally embarrassed, and you'll have to do a whole lot of learning on the job to get on board, and then you'll move way above everything we do in your specialty, and that's the way it's always going to be. I mean, you can't fill a classroom with students unless you're teaching general stuff that everybody knows. And to really succeed at a job, you have to know specific stuff to that job. So, but it's important that people understand that. And one thing that has amazed me is that I've had no students scream and yell and complain and storm out and say your class is too weak and lame. When they find out that it doesn't really prepare you to win these hacking competitions, they don't seem too astonished by that. But I did it because I want to know where we really are. If we're really worthless, let's find out and cancel the program. If we're really the best in the world, let's find out. But I think we're somewhere between those two. And so anyway, there's this other resource is, Easy CTF has write-ups every year. And the other resource is CTF Time. This is a website just to help you find Capture the Flag competitions. Everybody's here. They list all of them. They explain who wins. You can register here and have your team ranked against all the teams in the world. And the top team is always this one, the Plaid Parliament of Voting. That is Carnegie Mellon. It is, I believe, the NSA. The people are headed for the NSA. And just like they ought to, they are ahead of us the way Secretary was way ahead of every other horse. Here they are. They got 1,800. The number's US 1,200. The next one has 1,100. And we're down at like 100 or 200. That's the way it is. You're never going to beat them, but you can do some of the early things, and you can benefit from some of their training materials. Easy CTF, the Pico CTF came from them. So they really are at the cutting edge, and they're way ahead of all of us, and I don't think we'll ever catch up with them, but at least we're moving on the same path. So they find this ETFs here, they put write-ups, they have walkthroughs for the previous years, which is extremely helpful. It's a very good idea before doing a CTF to read the 8 solutions from last year so you have an idea what you're getting into. Quite a few of them have annoying things that aren't obvious, like there's ones from Eastern Europe all zip everything into XZ files, which I didn't know how to unzip. And other people, you can only do it by connecting to their screwy VPN, and all the challenges are local to the VPN. Things like that would just be annoying. It's good to find out from the previous year. So this was our fall 2005 season. I put on what percent we were in. We may have to be in the upper 10% several times. Some of them are just impossible. We can't get any of them hardly. But the easy CTF, we were actually in the top 10 briefly. I think we won it finished at 12th or 14th place. But that's cool. And of course, I'm under no illusions. The reason that happens is because the big shots don't even bother with the easy ones. They're focusing on the hard ones. I mean, if Carnegie Mellon and those other guys were there, we'd be down in the bottom, the 50th percentile, just like the other ones. But at least we're somewhere. And students are aware of what challenges are out there and to what extent they're being prepared to meet them, which is what I want. I mean, I'd like to teach the best class I can, but whether it's good or bad, I would like students to know what it's really worth, not have any illusions about it. So then students formed a hacking club. And they designed their logo. They didn't run this logo past me. And they showed me that logo. So you can't have a logo like that. I mean, this is obviously a line drawing of Gochi, one of the famous offensive wedge images on the internet. And yet, they liked it. And they said, you can't put a logo up like that. And they said, oh yeah, the college approved it, proposed it. And this sign had an interesting effect. They put these signs up on campus. And what happens is most people walk by because they don't even know what that is. Anybody that knows what it is, they join the club. And that's what hacking is all about. There's this in club with all this unsavory sort of dirty information that some people want to know and most people don't want to know. And it had the effect. Anyway, I told them I'm not making t-shirts with that logo on it, but they might. So I gave them a projector and they started bringing in speakers, and one of the students had a lot of good connections from DEF CON and other things and brought in a lot of really good speakers, and it became quite high morale. They cleaned up the lab to some extent, brought in a lot of technical expertise, and the hacking lab has always been a free fire zone. Now, I did this as soon as I started teaching the hacking class because I went to DEF CON. If you go to DEF CON, they warn you in the schedule, they warn you at the introductory speech, everybody say, don't use the network. If you use this network, you are volunteering to be the target of every attack in the world. And journalists and people are terrified and don't bring a computer. I always bring a computer to get attacked because it's good for me. I got hacked at DEF CON, I ended up on the wall of sheep. They got in my Gmail account. I didn't think it was possible. It was HTTPS, nobody could get in. Then I'm totally up there, they're in my account. Say, how did you do that? That was educational. They got in by stealing the cookie because until about 3 years ago, Gmail was not always HTTPS. It was HTTPS when they took your password, and then they would send a cookie in plain text after that so you could steal the cookie and get in somebody's account. Well, I didn't know that, and I learned. That's what I go there for. Of course, there's nothing confidential on my laptop that I take there. So I made the hacking lab in the same spirit. There's signs telling people just don't even go in here if you're trying to use a normal computer lab. There are dangerous people in here. Although, one thing I haven't put on the sign because I think it would not be effective, but it's true, is that my most dangerous course by far is computer forensics. The man that taught me computer forensics told me his course has caused 4 divorces so far. Because people go home and they run these forensic tools on their home machine and they find out what's happening when they're not home. And as anybody could tell you, there's Ashley Madison and all these sites, a whole lot of people are doing hanky-panky and they're successfully hiding this from their wife, but not if their wife runs computer forensics. Suddenly they're not able to hide that from her anymore. And then I have signs up saying don't do shopping in here, don't put in credit card numbers, make a different email account with a password you don't love to use in here. And this was mostly theoretical, because the attacks I was teaching weren't that powerful. But after I started doing the violent Python, my students got sharper, and so one of them wrote a Python keylogger and put it on all the machines, which I thought was bloody awesome. And so then we made a wall of sheep with real passwords in it and all these people. And by the way, a lot of these people are teachers in my department. Because I would tell them, don't use this lab, and they say, oh, it'll be all right, and I say, no, it won't. And I didn't know, but they were going in here. And after we did this, they don't go in there anymore. In fact, most of the teachers that teach non-security classes are sort of afraid of us, and they were like the dirty alley where the drug dealers hang out, don't go near there, try to keep their students from going in there. If you go in there, you're like, you're corrupted now, we don't want you coming back over to this side, you know. Which is more or less all true. Anyway, then we've had a lot of places we've sent these students. They were got them working at NASA Ames and OpenDNS. Lawrence Berkeley Lab has maybe 6 or 8 of our students. Several hired their full-time jobs. UCSF Medical Center. Uber just hired security engineer from our program over the summer. And so it's working. I mean, people are getting enough skills for entry-level positions in security with this stuff. And now we have a job fair. I've been in charge of the internship program for years, and I used to take resumes from students to try to match it to job descriptions, and I discovered what I think everybody's discovered, which is resumes are pretty much worthless. You don't actually find out the truth about anybody that way. So what I said, the simplest thing is I'm just getting out of the middle. I have a job fair. I invite the employers to show up, the students show up, and they talk to each other, and I just facilitate. You know, let's not pretend that I can pick the right candidate for you. You pick your own candidates. That's working a lot better. And a lot of people are getting jobs right on the spot there, or at least interviews on the spot, and that's the best I can do. So, of course, as you probably know, college administration is typically there only to prevent all progress. Although there are occasional rare spots that are doing something right by accident. They mostly exist just to distract people while they can steal the money, as far as I can tell. And so they tried to cancel the entire internship program because someone hadn't filled out a form on time. And anyway, I learned, this is how you have tenure. I learned that I can just break the rules, and I can just break essentially every rule at the college if you have tenure, because they can't fire you. It's like a marriage, they're stuck with me. So they keep passing rules that would outlaw everything I'm doing, and I just break them. But you learn how to break them without offending them too much. Like, well, I'm not allowed to teach Linux. The hacking course is like 3/4 Linux. I'm not allowed to teach Linux, that technically belongs to another department, but what that means is you can't put it in the title of the course, right, and you don't put it in the description of the course. But there's never any auditing process where they take the official description and compare it to what you teach. So you teach whatever the hell you want, but you make it look on paper like you're not teaching Linux, and then you're compliant. This is compliance. You know, that's the kind of security people don't like. Compliance is where you obey the letter of the law with complete disregard for whether it actually means anything. Like me, they say, you better stop sending nasty attacks out of our campus. I say, okay, I'll send them over HTTPS, and you'll be happy your sensor won't go off anymore. I'm like, if I actually cared about your complaint and wanted to stop doing that, that would be a whole different matter. But all I want to do is get you to stop whining at me, so that's compliance. And it's not even necessarily wrong. You get over this. Like, one thing I do is I teach lock picking. This is a big hit. Now I do it the first day. I got to Home Depot and got a bunch of locks. I went to DEF CON and the other conferences. I learned how to pick locks. And more importantly, I learned how to teach people how to pick locks by making locks with less pins so they're easier to pick, so you have gradual steps up. And that's a big hit. And it scares people to death. People think it's illegal. And so then I found one of the students in the hallway picking like a display case lock. And he thought I was going to scream and yell at him. I said, well, you know, it's no great harm. It's an empty display case. But the fact is, I said, you know, we really shouldn't be doing that too much, because if the other teachers walk by in the other departments, they will freak out. And this is the tough thing about this business. You have a bunch of skills that normal people are really bothered by. Like, they have a password. Oh, I'm safe. I put a password on a laptop and you're sticking. Ha, ha, ha. You know, I know four ways to steal right past that password. And so you have to somehow avoid exposing their illusions in a way that will make them freak out. So it's a tough thing. That's why you become kind of a pariah once you're a security hacking type person. They all come to me to get accounts on the machines because they know that the official IT department is so slow and useless you can't get anything done, and I can hack in and make an account for them anytime. So that's the standard way our department gets accounts, but they also don't trust you after they find out you do this. I'm also picking locks. People have padlocks stuck on things, you just go pick the lock. We have a IT tech that supposedly maintains the machines. She puts deep freeze on them and she puts padlocks on them. And I just, when I need to, I pick the lock, remove the deep freeze, put on my stuff, then put it back. And she has all these security measures which are completely pointless, but there's no way to convince them to let me do what I need to do, so I just do it anyway. And that's why I think the real point that it takes a while to get tenure is that you learn the correct way to break the rules. If you do it blatantly and embarrass people and obstruct things, then you're going to be in trouble. But if you're in the course of, if I'm not stealing passwords or credit card numbers to make money, I'm doing what I have to do to teach my class for legitimate reason in a way that doesn't interfere with another class, then it doesn't really matter. Anyway, we have a lot of guest speakers. I try to get one person from industry to come speak to every class every semester, and we have every couple of semesters a seminar course, which is just visiting speakers, giving job advice and other things. And this is very popular. I really like this because, you know, I learned what I think a lot of teachers learn, since there's an enormous gap between what's in textbooks and what's really done in the real world. And rather than try to hide from this, I decided I better just embrace it. So I say, look, you hear enough lectures from me, here's something from a guy in the real world. Like the security engineer from Netflix came and talked to our class, and he said, I asked him, you know, would you like to hire any interns? He said, no. I don't want any of your interns, and I don't want any of your graduates either. We don't hire anybody straight out of college because they're all too stupid. He was slightly more polite than that. But he said, they don't know how to write secure code. Well, our students don't either. I went to the CS department, I contacted their newest, most innovative teachers, saying, I'd like you to teach security. And they said, oh no, I don't touch security. That's a whole different department. It's all complicated. I don't know any of that. I just teach code. And that's the standard in this business. We train people to code vulnerable websites. They do what they got an A for in class, they do what the teacher told them to do, they take the example from the textbook, and they're making another generation of the same vulnerable crap, and then we hire a separate people called security engineers to patch it. It's kind of nuts, but that's the way the world is. It's job security for both of us. But anyway, so he said, at Netflix, we don't put up with that. We want people to write secure code, so we won't hire anybody unless they have 5 years of real on-the-job experience, which is the only place you learn that. And I asked him, is there any credential, degree, certificate anywhere that qualifies you to write secure code? And he said, no. There is nothing anywhere. There is no book. You just have to learn it in experience. And I would like to see that change someday, which is why I'm here, actually. I'm here because about 4 years ago, at a talk, Dan Kaminsky, you know, the most famous ethical hacker in the world, said, you guys should start going to coding conventions, because this is ridiculous. The coders are writing insecure stuff. They don't know anything about security. And we should go where they are. And the other thing which he was trying to address, he's been trying to do this for years. I have a lot of respect for Dan Kaminsky. And he really knows something about developing products. And most security experts don't really know how hard it is to develop something. So they're always saying, you guys are stupid, you're not trying. When you know they've written 10,000 lines of complicated stuff to make it beautiful and make it fast. And they don't worry about security because they got enough things to worry about. And Dan Kaminsky, he's saying, rather than calling them stupid and insulting them, you ought to be working with them, understanding what the problem is, understanding how to fix it. And what you really ought to do is make like a development environment where they don't have to know security, but the environment will make the stuff more secure. This is what Microsoft did. Microsoft had a huge security problem. Until 2002, their official policy was to ignore security. Their official policy was, there aren't very many hackers, we're wasting our time trying to protect things against deliberately malicious attacks, just make it so if an honest worker is trying to get their job done, it'll work. And if they make reasonable mistakes, it'll handle it. Don't try to dream up exotic attacks because that's just a bunch of waste of time. But in 2002, it had gotten so bad that everybody had dancing alligators and porn popping up on their screen and their machines were crashing and nobody could get any work done, and Microsoft reversed course. And Bill Gates wrote the trustworthy computing memo. He said, we are gonna reverse our official policy. From now on, security is our number one priority, making sure everything is secure. Even if that makes it harder to use, we got to be more secure because it's got out of hand here to where people, we can no longer take this laissez-faire attitude we've been having. And so they trained all their staff. They got a book called Writing Secure Code, and they code. They taught all their staff about security, and they rewrote Windows XP, and that was Windows XP Service Pack 2, which was their giant leap forward in security. And after that, like the Queen Mary, Microsoft was able to slowly reverse course, and now their stuff is really quite secure. And the last several major security scandals have been on the Linux side. And Apple and Microsoft are sitting here saying, you know, if you would pay for professionals to write your code, you would get better stuff. And that seems to be true now. It used to not be true emphatically, but they decided to care about security, and they put all their massive engineering efforts and fantastic wealth towards making more secure stuff, and it worked. So anyway, that's what I wanted to show you. And I'll take any questions if you got any. I know we were talking about a program earlier.
Yeah, I guess a little bit of disillusionment as a community college instructor as well, and that is that I understand the perspective of a programming department under CSIE, right? Okay, and to try to get them to address security.
But they've got an awful lot of stuff to cover already.
But a lot of that also is transferability to the next level college for us from a 2-year to a 4-year or whatever.
Yeah.
Do you ever maybe envision stuff that maybe part of the process could be to incorporate in the publishers, some secure coding in the textbook, which might help the instructor who's doing the CSIE to end up with not necessarily the industry experience, but some good tips that start prodding or priming the pump?
Well, one thing I've been thinking about for years is that we should have like one chapter on security in each book. If you learn PHP, it should teach you like the three biggest problems of PHP. If you learn C, it should teach you the three biggest problems in general terms, with maybe a couple examples, maybe one homework assignment. And that seems to be happening. There's a new thing I just saw. I think Facebook had it, like a secure coding workshop. They're trying to keep beta tested at our college. And I looked at it, and it wasn't even as much security as Security Plus. It was mostly coding, but it had a little about security in there, which is probably more realistic. I would think if anybody takes a class in a language, on the final exam, they should know at least like the top two security problems of that language. That's not asking too much.
Well, yeah, we're part of a big college too and stuff. So, I got some influences that time and stuff with Pearson or San Diego, whatever stuff. Try to push that back a little bit on our side.
Yeah.
I get it when somebody's in the industry and say, look, you're right, you hit it spot on, and that is you're in the inside, a scoop on everything, so you really know what that company is trying to defend against, and you have a sink or swim, or you won't be employed anymore, okay?
Yeah.
But if we don't do it on the education side, it's really hard, right, to get that person and turn that person if there's not an element. Now, you and I know that we could force them to take a class. You can't take a programming class until you have the security class first.
Yeah,
but that becomes just a side product. People find other ways to
My feeling, all community colleges, as far as I can tell, are vocational education.
Right.
We don't get to choose what we want to teach. We teach what you need to get a job.
Right.
And the fact is, I think coders who know a little security are much more employable.
Yeah.
But knowing like a whole Security Plus worth of security is not really benefiting them any. What they're doing then is becoming not good enough to be a security professional. So for that would be for security professionals, take like several security courses, now you're employable, or be a coder and take a bunch of coding courses, now you're employable. But there should be a little more security content in the coding course. And I'm trying to put more coding content in security classes because I've actually got people graduating who can't program in any language at all.
Seriously.
And most of them are always guided by the people who hire students. They say they got to know some languages. You're nowhere if you can't write at least one language. There's at least no Python, like what is this nonsense? And I agree. So now I put coding in the programming course, in the security classes.
Right, the other possibility is not to try to force it into the class, but like for our world, force it into the certificate. A programming class and a security certificate, or try to get the programming people to include a security class, and then that maybe that's the overlap that gives them enough to tie the two together.
Yeah, and I don't think it matters exactly how you implement it, but I think we need to move there. And that's why I see a lot of what most people do develop an interest in security, even if they started out in coding sooner or later. Once you get hacked a few times, it gets your attention. You see, I went to DEF CON the first time because Cisco got hacked. This guy named Michael Lynn was a security engineer at Cisco on contract, and he found out all these holes in Cisco routers. And he thought they weren't fixing them, so he revealed them all publicly at DEF CON. In violation of his confidentiality agreement, he might have gone to jail, but it was a very interesting talk. The FBI impounded all the disks, so they tried to tell him not to give the talk. I found like in Holland or something, someone posted a video of the talk and his slides because it was illegal to have them in America. I said, wow, this is interesting stuff. So I went to DEF CON, and I came back and talked to my department chair, and I said, there's this entire world of important information, and it's not in any of our classes. And I said, this is not right. So we started writing all these hacking and security classes, and I think, it's coming. And this artificial division will end someday. But to be fair, one thing that most security people will not like you to say this, but it is true. Coders who know nothing about security are in fact doing exactly what they should to accomplish security, because security is confidentiality, availability, and integrity. And the first thing you have to have is availability. It has to work and do something, or you've got nothing to secure. So they are correct. If you're making something new, your first job is to just make it work at all. And then you worry about attacks later. Like, until you have some assets to defend, there's no need for defenses. I had one thing I get a lot in classes. I get some guy that has a stupid idea to make some internet website. He thinks he's going to get rich. And I say, oh, should I like invest in security? And I say, dude, just put up the website in any form at all, and don't bother improving it until you have money coming in. This is my gentle way of trying to hit them with a splash of reality. Dude, nobody's ever going to play this stupid game anyway. So don't waste any money on it until you actually have people paying for it and money coming in. That would be the time to improve it.
Well, the general question is, when people hire, companies hire security engineers, is it more on the IT side? So if we, the improvement that you guys are talking about, then the security side will be done on the development side.
Both.
If you know the code.
See, both of these happen. If your company is primarily like baking muffins or something, then the only thing you have is IT security. You just don't want people hacking and stealing your employee social security numbers. But if you are a software developer, then you have to secure both your infrastructure and your products. So you don't have to waste so much time patching and updating your products.
Exactly.
So both those are different, but they both happen.
But I thought right now most companies, when they say they have a security engineer, it's more on the IT side.
Well, sure, because most companies do not produce software.
Okay.
So if what you produce is something else, then you don't have to worry about the security of your products. Although now, with the Internet of Things, even if you make toasters, your toasters are all connected to the Internet. And so they didn't think of that. So almost all the Internet of Things have no security in the actual product.
Mm-hmm.
And that's leading to all kinds of entertaining disasters, like the biggest DDoS in the world about 2 weeks ago from a bunch of webcams. Like 100,000 webcams all tried together to send a terabit per second of attack traffic. So they're all hackable. And so that's coming. But the first thing you think is, I'll protect my own stuff from outside. The next thing you think is, our customers might get hurt from all this crappy stuff we're selling them, but that's the next level. And typically, both improvements do not take place until they get hacked. Most companies ignore security until they get hacked, then suddenly they care. That's usually what it takes to wake them up. And that's why one thing I used to do, white hatting, where you find a vulnerability, you contact a company and tell them you have a problem, I had to give it up. It's technically illegal, which I didn't understand until I got in trouble at the University of Louisiana. I found a bunch of credit card, a bunch of 2,000 records of medical patients' procedures at the University of Louisiana Health Center, and I contacted their HIPAA office and said, dude, you ought to put that stuff behind a password, and they did. And then 4 months later, they published a legal article saying that the security breach was me hacking into them, stealing their stuff as a demonstration for class, which got me in trouble. It was, a lot of that was false, but I went to my lawyer and I said, they said I broke the law. How can they say that? And he said, well, technically you did break the law. And I was like, what? I searched, found this stuff on Google. He said, yeah, if you search on Google and find something that you know shouldn't be there and you click on the link, you just broke the law. I knew that I'm not supposed to be able to see health records, so I'm supposed to not look. That's the legal position. If I had not looked, or if I'd gone to the Google cache, then I'd say, Google broke the law, not me. I didn't do a nasty thing like look. But so I didn't know how bad it was. The CFAA is hard to believe until you get slapped by it. But that's why if people, the basic rule of professionals, this is hard to take, but the rule of professionals is if you find a vulnerability on a website, ignore it and let them get hacked. Because if they cared, they would have a bug bounty or disclosure program. If they don't have one, then they're obviously too stupid to live and let them get hacked. And this is the heartless position that you must take. If you try to help them, you are just placing yourself at risk. When you tell them, you're confessing to a crime. And now you're rolling the dice to see if they prosecute you. It's hard to put up with. But
it's hard for our students to quite get that jump, too. Because
it is.
There's a part of it in education that says, look, that's how I prove my resume. That's how I prove myself. And that's why an employer might be interested in hiring me, because I've been able to, you know, discover these things.
Yeah. And this is a huge issue in the hacking community, is you do things which you perceive as a benefit to the world and a public service, and the other side perceives you as a dangerous criminal attacking them. And that is the nature of the business. That's why I push the maybe one of your classes should be a CISSP prep, because that is the cert everyone needs. And the whole point of the CISSP is all your technical people have to learn some management, and all your managers have to learn some technical stuff exactly to breach this divide. Because the typical situation at a company is the CEO is up here making deals and moving the company forward, and there's this crazy hacker guy wearing the wrong clothes, babbling binary all the time, and all they know is he's always mad about something. Every time I see him, he's screaming, you gotta do this, you gotta do that, but I can't understand a word he says. And every time I talk about firing him, he says, oh no, if you fired him, everything would stop working. He's the only one that knows what's going on. And he said, why do I have a lunatic that seems terribly unhappy and disloyal that is crucial in my company? This is not good. And they're trying to create a new generation of managers and IT workers that are closer to each other, so this doesn't have to keep happening. And I think the secret is you have to respect somebody to influence them. The boss has to respect that guy's technical skills, and that guy has to respect the boss, which is hard. I was the IT guy, and all I could tell authority figures just seemed to be complete morons like Gilbert's boss that just were there to ruin your life. But the fact is, when I got old enough to be more like management, I began to understand how hard it is to be management. Like, parents just seem to be there just to ruin your life. But the fact is, they're doing a job that is different than the job of the kid. Yeah. And it involves saying no. And it's not that they're just evil and cruel, it's that their job actually requires them to place limits on the people below them. So I try to teach them this, especially when you teach them things like lockpicking seems to bring it up more than anything else. See, now you know a skill that will scare everyone else to death. And so you have to handle this skill in a way that does not make too much trouble, or you'll end up having everybody mad at you. But that's the same thing, teach them how to drive a car or shoot a gun. These are skills that have a good use and a bad use. Anyway, any other questions? Well, I reckon that's it. I'll turn off to get out of the way for the next speaker. Thank you. All right, get rid of this thing. Oh yeah, code camp.